Let's not be morbid about it. Let's not be all serious about it. Let us use a weapon that the community uses very regularly, which is humor, and use humor as an opportunity to tell them facts about themselves and how they lead their lives. And I can say with actually great pride that a huge impact.
So, an essential part of the Jio Parsi campaign was first. Advocacy, and then, you know, medical advice and intervention, accompanied by financial subsidy for that expensive medical intervention.
So although this is a community issue, had to address and tackle and change individuals' opinions and beliefs in a way. So all.
Friends, and welcome to Jio Parsi's Friday Forum. I am absolutely delighted that we have two very, very special people here with us, Sam Balsara and Raj. I think it's not just Jio Parsi and Parzor who have to thank Sam and Raj and Lara and the Madison team. I think the entire Parsi community and all those interested in the heritage of humanity have to say a big thank you to them. The first time I met Raj and Sam was under a little peculiar circumstance. I was at a meeting in Bombay, and I told the Federation representatives that we started Jio Parsi almost a year ago, and there has been very little response. We really need to have something which brings it alive. The next day I was told, please go downstairs, Sam Balsara is waiting for you. This was Bombay in summer, very hot. A dapper man with very, very nice clothing and a very artistic man with a ponytail, who I guessed had to be something to do with advertising and creatives, were waiting downstairs along with other people. There was no place to sit. We were in the Banaji Atasbeeram grounds. And I was so ashamed that I had to take them finally to an outshed where there was stored furniture, which was all very dusty. And Sam in his perfect suit and Raj very fashionable had to sit on uncleaned furniture. But the minute I began talking about Jio Parsi, I knew I had come to the right place. They were true professionals. They heard me out. They asked very serious questions. And from that day onwards, I am honored to say we are friends. Before I leave it to Raj, I have something else I must share with you. I have been fortunate enough to know two Sams in my life. One was the person who named me, who knew me from the time I was born, Sam Manekshaw, and he gave us the honor of making his film, which we released on his 90th birthday. Both Sams are very similar, you know. They both are brilliant professionals. They both are very, very good looking and dapper. They both dress well. They both have very kind hearts. They both have two daughters, grandchildren whom they dote on. And most interesting, when I was doing the research for Sam Balsara's program, I realized that both had family homes in Balsar. So if you want your child to be a leader, either you go and take him to Balsar and let him get born and educated over there, or we all need to go to Balsar and learn lessons from Sam Balsara. And of course, we've already recorded the lessons of Sam Manekshaw. Welcome, Sam and Raj. Thank you for sparing the time to be with us. Thank you for sparing so much time over the photos which we insisted. And I'm sorry I was curt today and said you have to be here at 5:45 and I wasn't here. God bless you. Thank you so much and welcome all of you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Raj Nair, as Shanaz has very kindly sort of introduced me. I'm the CEO and the Chief Creative Officer of Madison BMB, which is the advertising agency part of Madison World, which is India's largest independent communication specialist network. And Sam Balsara, who I have the unique honor of introducing and interviewing, is the founder and the chairman of Madison World. But I've decided to not interview Sam and spend the next 1 hour just reading out his achievements, because I think even 1 hour is not enough for that, quite honestly. Okay, I'm just kidding. I'll just at least give you a glimpse into who Sam Balsara is and what he has done over the course of his working life. To start with, for the last 11 consecutive years in the Economic Times Brand Equity, they have named him as the most influential person in media. He's the recipient of the IAA Leadership Award for Media Agency Professional of the Year in 2013. Economic Times Brand Equity has also rated him as the third most influential person in advertising in 2015. He has been conferred the Lifetime Achievement Award by the Advertising Agencies Association of India in 2009. He's received the Hall of Fame Award from the Advertising Club of Calcutta in 2008. He's among DNA's 50 most influential people in Mumbai in 2006. In 2004, Midday named him as the fourth most powerful man in Indian advertising and the media scene. He's received the Dainik Bhaskar Media Services Person of the Year Award. He's been a jury member at the International Festival of Advertising in Cannes, which is considered the global mecca of advertising, twice in 2005 and 2014. And he's on the global power list of Campaign magazine in the top 100 most influential people in advertising around the world. On top of all of that, Madison, of course, is among the top five global independent agencies in the world. Madison has been Agency of the Year at the Digis 2019, TV Media Agency of the Year at the Primetime Awards multiple years over, Mobile Media Agency of the Year at IDMA, second most powerful media agency as reckoned by Brand Equity, PR Agency of the Year 2013. Madison BMB has been Agency of the Year at the Dainik Bhaskar Inc. Awards in 2016. It just goes on and on and on in terms of accolades and achievements, right? That in a nutshell, in a very, very short nutshell, is Sam Balsara. He's also been the past president of 3SFI, the past chairman of NRSC, the past chairman of the Advertising Standards Council of India, past president of the Advertising Club of Bombay, three terms, no less, past chairman of the AAAI Awards, editor of Solus of the Ad Club magazine, and committee member of the Marico Innovation Foundation. That's not exhausting, that's inspiring, right? But that, in a nutshell, like I said, is Sam Balsara. Sam, an absolute pleasure. To sort of have engaged in this session with you. So without further ado, if we could start with you, and that is a very young Sam at Balsar. So let's start with a few details about your childhood and your early family life, where you grew up. What was it like growing up in Balsar?
Well, my father is from Balsar. My father's family is from Balsar. So although I was born in Bombay, I spent my early life in Balsar up to standard five. Now, Balsar would best be described by people on this webinar as a one-horse town. But I believe I've come to realize in later years in life that actually living in a small town is a serious advantage for an advertising and a marketing professional. And I say that, Raj, because I believe that when you live in a small town, you really get to understand real people, their motivations, their desires, their wants, and you get to see all of it in its raw and real form. You know, in the city folk have sort of mastered the art of camouflaging. They project their personality, what they want others to see them as, and very often their actions are not sort of consonant with what their inner heart feels or their mind feels. So that is why I say it's a big advantage to have grown up in Balsar in my earlier years, though it was a very short while, because in the sixth standard I moved to Bangalore.
Right. So you shifted from Bangalore, and there, which, I mean, if I was to ask you, between Balsar and Bangalore, when you look back at least, Is there a sense of the place that you liked more, perhaps, between Balsar and Bangalore?
Well, I mean, obviously, clearly, I liked Bangalore. It was a very, very big and a mega change from me moving from a small town in Gujarat to a very, I would say, a westernized, sophisticated city like Bangalore. It was even more pleasant in those days than it is now, with, you know, wide roads and big bungalows with gardens
And the two garden city, I suppose, at that time.
Yes, indeed. And I mean, it's not just the big public gardens, but also most of the individual houses and bungalows had nice tended gardens, and it was indeed a lovely city. And I think it definitely, I think, helped me, and the change was wonderful for me, thanks to the bold move taken by my dad.
Right.
If I may, talking about my dad reminds me that, you know, my dad was actually doing our family business, which was actually that of forest contracting. And actually late in his life, I don't know how old he was then, but he must definitely be, would have crossed 50. This business got nationalized. And then he took the bold step of moving from what I call a one-horse town, Balsar, to Bangalore, where he bought a, you know, what I would call a Western-style hotel called Mesh's Hotel. And that is how we moved to Bangalore. And it was indeed a very bold move on his part. He had sort of never worked for anybody else in his life. In Balsar, he was running his own business with with my grandfather.
Right.
And when that business went away overnight, he made this bold move, which I believe was indeed very good for me and good for the family as a whole.
I'd say the fruit hasn't fallen far from the tree, Sam. The boldness you would have pretty much inherited from him in most of your decision making as well. This is the school, I believe, the school where you studied at in Bangalore.
Yes, this motto is quite interesting. Nec dextrosum, nec sinistrosum. And, you know, whilst I was in the school, I may not have given it too much attention.
Right.
But I must say, later on in my working life, I took this motto to heart. What it translates to, neither to the left nor to the right. And over the last almost 48 years of working life, I've been strongly focused, earlier 16 years in the job at hand when I worked for somebody else, and I was 100% dedicated to them. And in the 33 years of Madison, nothing has taken away my attention other than Madison. So neither to the left nor to the right, but straight on. So, you know, over the years, especially in the last 20 years, we have received many proposals to, you know, start a school, get into construction, start a restaurant, do all kinds of things which indeed were very profitable and sounded very attractive. But between
I believe Sam's connection.
The founding principle of mine now.
I think we've lost Sam to a connection. Can somebody help out, please?
Yeah.
No, Sam seems to be back now.
I'm back.
Yeah, okay, great.
Raj, I can't hear you though.
Can you hear me now? Can you hear me, Sam? I think... Has Sam dropped off again? No, Sam is there.
I'm there, but I can't hear you, Raj.
Maybe we can switch off the video for a while just so that
Okay,
we get the bandwidth back and then
Okay, I'll switch off my video. Let Sam's video be on.
Okay, great.
Right. Sorry. Yeah. So you were. Yeah. So we got that bit about your motto. That's quite an interesting. So the unflinching focus was sort of inculcated early, even if, like you said, you did not sort of connect the dots right then and there, but you did sort of make the connections later in life, which is absolutely brilliant. And I guess all the other businesses that were proposed to you, it's more their loss and advertising's gain that you have stayed focused on advertising and media. So, which is, as far as I can
Hopefully.
See, it's definitely not a complaint from our side for sure. Matab, if you could share the next slide, please. Yeah, that's an amazing picture of your parents and your siblings. While growing up, just wanted to know, how were they? How were your parents with you and your brothers? Were they very relaxed? Were they strict? Was one more strict than the other? Or were they both relaxed? Just if you could talk us through that.
No, I would say they brought me up in a very liberal way and they were quite relaxed. I didn't have too many sort of strict rules in terms of time to study or time to get back home after play or not later on in life as a teenager, not going out late at night and stuff like that. But I think in hindsight, they did sort of teach me to evaluate for myself in my mind the difference between what is right and what is wrong and what is good and bad. So I could take my own decision and discriminate in what's good and what's not, rather than somebody else, monitoring me and telling me this is not good for you.
Got it. Fabulous. I was just reflecting on the picture of you with your brothers, to me at least, if I may, you clearly look like the naughtiest of the three.
I am the youngest of the three. My
right.
two brothers came a year or two apart, and then I came after 10 years. So you could say, a slightly different generation.
Right. Right. So what was the naughtiest thing you did as a teenager that you can now share with us?
Oh my God. I don't think I did too many sort of exceptionally naughty things. But maybe one thing, I don't know if you would call this naughty, but a significant event in my teenage life during my early college days was, we had a gang of friends, some of whom were from Bombay and Scooter, and we had a friend actually who worked, who studied at the Bangalore Dairy, which was a little far away. And one day post dinner, we all decided to move out on bikes to meet him, which was a little far away, and we had to go on a slightly broad but lonely road. And there we saw a bit of a commotion of a guy trying to sort of overpower a woman. And I don't know what got into us, but sort of chivalry, I think, took over. And all of us stopped and we started sort of admonishing the man and telling him to lay off and stuff like that. And the guy told us to look, just get on. This is none of your business. But we sort of, in our wisdom, persisted and said, nothing doing. You leave her alone. And suddenly, we didn't know, within 2 minutes, we had a gang of people who came with rods and bamboos. And one of my friends got a big shot on the head and his almost ear fell off. Another friend of mine fell unconscious. I had to run for my life. So this was clearly a significant event I remember from my teenage years in Bangalore when we used to go around town on a two-wheeler.
Right. I mean, okay, that's the absolute opposite end of the spectrum from naughty, but clearly, at least...
Well, I think sort of going out at night on that lonely road at 10 o'clock at night and taking the move of trying to help. I mean, we don't know if she needed help or, you know, it was just our interpretation of that she needed help. So, but it was certainly a foolish thing to do under the circumstances, as hindsight showed.
No, but because incredibly chivalrous.
Two of my friends were seriously affected. I mean, they were in hospital for a month.
Oh my gosh. Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. But that's standing by the principle of doing the right thing is an absolutely fabulous thing. So really something for us to sort of, you know, pick up from. So here, also wanted to ask you from your teenage years or even earlier, from when you were an adolescent or a child, what are the kind of things perhaps that you or your parents, you know, did in the in terms of keeping the tradition and the heritage of the Parsi heritage and tradition alive in your early years? How what are the kind of things that you did?
So Bangalore had a very small population of only about 300 Parsis.
Right.
You know, so Parsis were insignificant in Bangalore. But despite that, the 300 Parsis were a very close-knit community. And, you know, we had a Bangalore Parsi club and a Parsi fire temple next to each other. And the Parsi club provided quite a sort of rallying ground for all the Parsis to meet. And I think we met most of the Parsis, or many of the Parsis met on Sunday evenings, and there was some function or the other. And twice a year, there were plays and, you know, our Parsi-Gujarati nataks, in which I used to take part regularly. So there was a fair bit of Parsi influence, although I lived in Bangalore, where the Parsi community was insignificant. Personally, on me, there was a fair amount of influence. And even in my school, I had two young Parsi friends who were quite close to me, and who, in a way, I'm frequently in touch with even now. So I would say there was a bit of Parsi influence on me as I grew up, even in cosmopolitan Bangalore.
So in Bangalore, in fact, where did you go to? Where did you go to college?
After Bishop Cotton's, I went to St. Joseph's College. You know, first to do my PUC,
right,
and then actually to I did the BCom course.
So in
PUC, actually, I had my first failing, academically speaking, because I failed in Hindi, and I had to lose a year because of that.
Oh, okay. So that clearly your Hindi teacher can't have been a favorite, but was there a favorite professor?
That's good. Yes, actually, now that you ask me, I did have a favorite professor, not because I think so much I loved the subject. He was a history professor and I didn't much care for history. But he had a unique tact of, you know, starting almost every lecture or every other lecture with a nice joke.
Oh.
And, you know, that really endeared him to me. And one of the jokes I even remember today was that a minister's son had to be admitted to Bishop Cotton's school, and he was a real duffer. So, and the principal was obliged to take him. So he told the teacher, look, you give him a very easy test, but he still failed it. So finally, the principal himself decided to give him a test. And he said, spell the word coffee. If you get even one alphabet right, you are passed and you'll gain admission into the school. And our young friend said, oh, that's quite easy. It's Kapi, K-A-P-H-I. So that's something that has stayed with me all my life. In fact, there's another incident from my school days that I recall. You know, in one of the school assemblies, we had a guest sort of lecture from some prominent person, and he told all the teachers that, you know, you must be especially good to all the clever students in the school, because later on, you know, when you want guest lecturers and all that, you know, they will come in handy. And he ended by saying, but be particularly kind to the duffer, because when you want to put up a new administrative block or you want to tear down the old buildings and redo all the buildings, then actually it will be the duffer who most probably would have become an industrialist by then. You will need him for a fat donation. Brilliant. So that too has stayed with me for a long time.
Brilliant. Which then brings us to your MBA days, which you did from Jamnalal Bajaj. And that's you right in the center in that red circle, right? Why did you
pick... This was an offsite at Bajaj.
Yeah. So why did you pick Bajaj Institute for your MBA?
Oh, come on, Raj. I didn't pick Bajaj. In those days, there were, you know, hardly, this was 1970, there were hardly four or five good management institutes, and they had only 30 to 40 seats each. Right. And there were lakhs of applicants. So, you know, I was selected by Bajaj as one of the 30 from thousands and thousands, I was greatly elated. So obviously I readily accepted and flew down from Bangalore and joined Bajaj Institute. I of course had also applied to IIM Ahmedabad because my older cousin Ronnie had passed out from there, but I did not get in to IIM Ahmedabad.
So IIM's loss was Bajaj's gain, which is absolutely fine. Yeah. So that's all about your growing up, your school, college, and even your post-graduation and so on, which brings me to how and when did you meet Humay?
So Humay is my cousin, and I used to be in Bangalore and she was in Bombay, but I used to meet her at least once a year when I came down from Bangalore for my annual vacation to Bombay. So my mother is from Bombay. So the house I live in today it was built by my grandfather from the maternal side. It's almost 85 years old. Whoa. So I used to come here for my vacation. So at that time, I used to meet her. But I would say probably love blossomed during my Bajaj days when I lived in Bombay.
Right. What do you remember about your wedding day?
gosh, that was a long, long time ago. One of the things I remember when I got married, I was in Cadbury, and Cadbury had a very stylish managing director called McPhee. And, you know, the way some of my friends later told me that the way McPhee made a grand entry into your wedding, it was as if he was the bridegroom.
Amazing. Okay. Good. He didn't. Good. It was just an impression he created in that sense. So we read in an interview that you had given that you learned a lot from travel on work from your first job, right? From your first job, right? Your Sarabhai Chemicals days. So just talk to us about your learnings from your travel days, from your first job.
Most of my traveling around the country, India, I did during my Sarabhai, 4 years in Sarabhai. I used to travel almost 10 days a month, and especially into smaller towns and sometimes even villages. And I do believe that traveling to small towns actually helped give me a tremendous grounding in, you know, Indian consumer markets, consumer behavior, and a very good understanding of wholesale markets, the way they work, what makes them tick, and retailers, how they behave, and, you know, insights about consumer, wholesale, and retail business. I got firsthand because of my extensive travel to different parts of the country. And I do feel that today's brand managers don't travel enough. And, you know, they leave the sales bit of it a lot to the sales management teams of the companies, and thereby they miss out on some very important insights on their brands.
Yeah, that's the, but I guess where you went to from Sarabhai, which is Cadbury, one good thing that they do is they actually make you spend time in both marketing and sales, which sort of rounds them off. But you, from your Cadbury days, you left Cadbury to start contract advertising, which was your, I guess, your first foray into advertising.
Yes, that's true.
What made you do that? Because Cadbury, the world's largest confectionery company, and contract being started by what was Hindustan Thompson Associates in those days, a subsidiary company of Hindustan Thompson, not as well known. Why did you do that? What made you want to do that?
So, you know, I had already finished 4 years in Cadbury as a brand manager or as a brand group manager, and added to my 4 years in Sarabhai as first a management trainee and then a brand manager. I had spent 8 years in brand management. And I believe that, you know, advertising was actually a big part of the brand manager's role. So I thought, after 8 years, why don't I get firsthand knowledge of advertising, and, you know, which would make me a sort of more complete advertising person. You know, the other dimension of brand manager's job was sales management, and that I thought I had got enough exposure to because of my extensive travels in Sarabhai days. So I thought advertising was the missing link for me to hit the top spot in marketing. So I thought a few years in advertising would sort of prepare me for a top slot in marketing in a good company. And that is why I joined Contract. And although Contract was kind of new, it was being started by the country's largest advertising agency, HTA or JWT. So I thought it was a safe bet. And of course, I had heard about Mamat Khan, the creative director, and he was the creative director of Contract. And so it appealed to me to join him.
Right, right. And plus you had Mr. Subhash Ghoshal.
Yes, of course. And I met Subhash Ghoshal there, and he was indeed a fine gentleman. Till today, I recall him very fondly. And in fact, as you know, I'm now the sole surviving member of the Subhash Ghoshal Foundation.
Oh, okay.
And at least once a year, I hold a function in his memory.
Wow.
I'm doing my little bit to keep his memory alive. Of course, last year we couldn't have the function because of the lockdown.
Right.
I hope I'll be able to have it this year.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. I hope, I most definitely hope you're able to do that. But let me ask you this. So in everybody's eyes, Cadbury, like I said, is a much larger company, well-known. The whole world knows the company. When you chose to move to contract, what is the reaction of Homai? How did your parents feel about that? Was this discussed at all between yourselves?
So my parents, I think, thought that I was moving a bit too often.
Right.
That, in sort of 8 years, this is going to be my third job, and why are you moving so frequently? And I also recollect that when I joined advertising, like that famous conversation in David Ogilvy's book, I could not explain to my parents what was my role as head of client service, because they just assumed when I said advertising, oh, you create the ads. When I said, no, I don't create the ads, then what do? Then you sell the product. No, I don't sell the product. But then what the hell do you do? I mean, why are they hiring you and why are they paying you if they don't create the ads, nor do you sell the product? In fact, I remember a similar incident that I could not explain to my grandfather in Balsar when I had gone there during my Sarabhai days, why I was traveling so much and what I was achieving for my company by spending so much of company's money.
Right.
If I was not actually selling the company's product. I mean, there is the need to go to so many places for 10 days every month, and you're not even selling the company's product. So these are, of course, interesting conversations that are, in my memory. But I think Homai's reaction was actually quite strange. She didn't have a particular reaction, but in jest, she said that, there goes my dream of ever occupying the managing director's bungalow, which was by the side of the Cadbury office, in the same compound. If you remember, Raj.
Yes, yes, the apartment. Yes.
That was not the apartment. Before the apartment, there was a bungalow, and the Cadbury managing director always lived there. So my wife said in jest that, there goes my chance of living there at some future date and time.
Completely understand her shock.
As Cadbury was very prominently located at the junction of Bulabai Desai Road or Warden Road, as we used to call it.
Right.
And it was an iconic bungalow in Bombay.
Right. So from Cadbury, of course, like we said, you moved to contract. Is there given that you were one of the founder members at contract, was there a particular sort of standout moment that you had at contract, something that you really remember, something that you cherish?
Well, I think I have had lots of, interesting moments with Mohammed Khan, both at a professional level and at a personal level and at an amusing level, I think, at the office, because, he was at the same time charismatic, a little eccentric, but a man with very strong views, who always wanted to have his creative finally come out in print in those days or in cinema. and didn't take too kindly to anybody who sort of had anything contrary to say.
Right.
So there were some amusing incidents. What else would I say? I think, of course, one standout moment was the Charms launch of Charms cigarettes. As you know, that was a dramatic moment where the packaging itself was so brilliant. We had
the denim pack,
and we had some outstanding photographs by one Indian, but who was residing abroad and who was fortunately for us in Bombay on a holiday. And Mohammed convinced him to take these outstanding photographs of young people, smoking. Those days, there was no taboo on smoking. And, we were free to show young people showing smoking cigarettes and stuff like that. So Charms was indeed a huge success. And I still remember the line,
Sam.
Yeah, Charms is the spirit of freedom. Charms is the way you are.
Correct. I have had the unique pleasure of not just, working with you, but I've worked with Mohammed as well. So.
Oh, wonderful.
A lot of experiences with Mohammed myself as well. Around the same time, Sam, your first child, Tanya, was born. What did you feel when she became an entrepreneur like you?
Well, I mean, she's an entrepreneur in a way, in a different sense. She does social work. I sort of remember that, she was born on the second day of my joining contract.
Right.
And actually, the same day from Breast Candy Hospital, I went to the contract office in the afternoon and I met Subhash there. And he told me that, Sam, you're lucky. Lakshmi has entered your house. I remember that. Of course, there was tremendous excitement over Tanya's birth. Little did I know that a few months later, my world is going to come crashing down when we discovered that Tanya has a problem with her eyes and soon she's going to be blind because, she suffered from a disease called retinitis pigmentosa, which is a progressive disease. She has not allowed that to come in her way, and she leads now a busy life. Fortunately, she did a course in learning computers, and now she's putting that to good use by teaching other blind children how to use computers. And she does this completely free of cost for other people like her. And unfortunately, in India, most of the blind people come from an extremely poor economic background,
right,
who have no exposure to computers or anything even close to computers. And yet it is true that, for a blind person, a computer can actually provide a window to the world. So now, Madison has also adopted Tanya Computer Center as our CSR activity.
Right.
And now we have 4 centers in Gujarat also that are running. And, hundreds of students are passing out from it and hopefully getting a livelihood. So that is a very satisfying thing that my Tanya does. And she also is a sort of a guide, philosopher, and friend to all her students and her large circle of friends. So she leads a purposeful life. This lockdown has been particularly hard on her because we've not been able to run classes. And I hope, therefore, that it ends soon.
Right. We'll really sort of hope and wish for that. Most definitely, in the in the near future, hopefully in the next couple of months or so, if things start improving, that then she should be resuming her services, making sure that the center is back up and running, which is fantastic. But back to you for a minute. From contract, you moved to Mudra.
Yes.
And what is it like leading Mudra to success?
So the I must say the initial few weeks in Mudra were a big shock. I think the first big shock was that Saturday was full day working at Mudra. But I must say, looking back, I think Mudra prepared me for my later life the way no other workplace has done. Because Mudra, you know, being an Ambani company, actually had a terrific work ethic. And as an agency, I think it really was indeed very different from most other la-di-da agencies of those times.
Right.
You know, we were hardworking, we were result-oriented. There were no pink gins at lunchtime. And, you know, we used to work Monday to Saturday morning to late night. We used to turn out campaigns in one day, sometimes from morning to evening. Because, you know, the job had to be done. There was no excuse. And all deadlines had to be met. So I think all of that actually prepared me for later life. And I think it helped create the grounding. So I must be grateful to Mudra for, you know, actually preparing me to you know, achieve something later on in life because of the work ethic that I learned from Mudra.
So is it fair to say that the seeds of medicine and starting medicine was sown while you were at Mudra?
Yes, definitely. But you know, actually, I must confess that, you know, I never had this dying ambition or anything like that to be an entrepreneur. What actually happened is that Mudra, after its initial success, possibly because of the Ambani influence, soon developed the ambition of wanting to be the largest agency in India. They said, why should a foreign agency be the largest agency in India? It should be an Indian agency.
Right.
And I, for one, thought that I'm not the one cut out to lead a large agency. I thought my personal priority was that I preferred to be a craftsman than a manager of just men and materials and money, which you invariably become when you're the head of a large agency. So in those days, my idealistic thinking was that a good agency is a small agency with a few large clients.
Right.
And that is why this seed was sown in my head when actually I took 1 week off for my Tanya Lara's Navjot. And I must confess or say that relatively, it was easy for me to start Madison because I spoke to two of our clients, Godrej and Nelco, who I used to service personally. They readily agreed. Then another friend of mine introduced me to an agency called Madison, which was, not doing well and which had the accreditation and which had the premises. So I took that agency over, first got an 80% share, and then over the next 2-3 years bought the remaining share. So I must say I started out easy. And true to my belief, you know, for the first 4 years, we did not go beyond two clients. Not that clients didn't come to us or we were not called to pitches, but I thought it was too risky, or I was afraid to spread myself too thin or to let down my two existing founder clients because I knew my management bandwidth was limited. So you know, in hindsight, I don't know if that is stupidity or actually sheer genius.
Well, I mean, anyways, nobody can complain with the way things turned out, for sure, because we all know what Madison has grown on to become. But having said that, this time, what was Homai's reaction when you started Madison? So first you denied her the bungalow in the Cadbury compound. So what was the reaction to you starting Madison?
So I kind of don't remember the initial reaction, but I remember her telling me about 1 year or so down the road that, you know, I thought now with your own company, you will be spending more time at home, but instead I find that you're working even harder and longer hours. So what's happening?
Right. Yeah, I mean, the entrepreneurial spirit has to sort of prevail in that sense. Absolutely.
Correct.
So from the, yeah, so here are some amazing pictures of the people you've met.
That's, Maurice Levy there from Publicis, the CEO from France.
Right, absolutely. Matab, if you could go on. Yeah, and that's the DMBMB party in Hong Kong.
This is in Hong Kong.
Yeah. And Prince Edward himself, I think this is what the, at if the yacht club, if I'm not
mistaken. At the Taj.
Okay. And the Star
this Kong. This is in Chicago.
Right.
Jack Cruz of Starcom.
At this, yeah. So, Matab, if you could stop here. I don't think people in India know enough about how you personally have molded India's TV watching habits. If you could throw light on this.
So, you know, there was a time, I think around, let's say, what would it be? Around 1985. Where television, I think, became freely available, the prices dropped, and, you know, more and more people could afford color televisions and stuff like that. And still, there was nothing useful or nothing very interesting or entertaining to watch on television. So actually, the industry, you know, and of course, that included me, conceived of a scheme that we call the sponsored program scheme, which we took to the minister of INB Sathe at that time,
right,
and he readily approved it. And under that scheme, you know, Doordarshan would accept ready-made produced programs, you know, and put them on air, and we would have to we would have to pay a telecast fee, but get a certain amount of free FCT. So actually, I took this opportunity and played a leadership role here. And I created many programs, you know, to recall some. I noticed you managed to get a Rajni poster.
Yes. So
Rajni was one of my first programs. I convinced Basu Chatterjee actually to make this program for me. And I took it to Godrej, and Godrej agreed to sponsor it. And it came on Sunday mornings, and it was a huge hit. Then I convinced Ramesh Sippy to make Bunyad. It came twice a week on Tuesdays and I think Saturdays, if I remember right, at 9 p.m. Then there were so many programs, but one another very interesting and pioneering one was Shanti. You know, in those days, one funny thing about television was that people used to watch television only between 8 and 9:30 p.m. or between 9 and 10 p.m.
Right.
So we thought, I mean, why should, what about the rest of the hours? And Doordarshan used to play some rubbish. So we thought that, you know, afternoons is a good time when actually housewives are free from their household chores. And most of the FMCG companies actually, including our Procter & Gamble and Godrej, would want to reach out to these housewives. So why don't we create the afternoon viewing habit? So with that in mind, we created Shanti. We wanted to create a one-year-long soap. In those days, Doordarshan gave approval only for 13 episodes. I had the gumption to convince Doordarshan to give me 265 episodes, Monday to Friday, at 3 o'clock in the afternoon. It took me about a year, but I finally got it through. Then I got Ronnie Screwvala's UTV to produce it. And, you know, the rest, as they say, is history. I mean, within about 2-3 months, the program became a huge hit. It got almost 75% of the viewership of 9 p.m. prime time. And my clients were laughing all the way to the bank because they were able to get, very high viewership at extremely low rates because we were producing 265 episodes. You know, the rate per episode was very low. And because it was non-prime time, even the telecast charges were very low. But the output was very good. You know, this is one of the things I'd learned in my Bajaj school, that the key to management is to improve the input-output ratio. You know, if you're inputting one, your output should be 100. That is what good management is. So Shanti was like that. You know, if you bought a 9 p.m. program after it is successful, you put in 80 rupees and then you got 100 rupees. But with Shanti, I put in 1 rupee and I got 80 rupees return. Amazing. So that's what I mean by maximizing the input-output ratio. And that, I believe, is what management is all about.
And plus, all these people became household names and you pretty much launched their career.
Yes, absolutely.
Mandira
Bedi of Shanti and... There are so many more programs we used to have at a time 4 to 5 programs on air for at least 4-5 years running.
Amazing.
I also played actually a leading role in helping Star come to India in a way, or not come to India, but, you know, make English viewing popular because, you know, at that time, Bold and Beautiful, I was enamored by, and I took the program to Godrej, and Godrej agreed to sponsor this English program, and that was one of the first big sponsorships on Star that helped Star get started on a commercial basis in India.
Oh, amazing. And which then spawned all the other shows like Dynasty and all of those coming.
Yeah, correct.
Amazing. So, Sam, it's been for you, it's been 33 years now, right? 1988, you started Madison, and now we are in 2021. These are just some pictures of the kind of parties that were associated with the milestones. But it's always a tightrope act, right? Balancing the professional and the personal life. What have you been your sort of principles at play here? In terms of balancing that?
So, I don't take seriously this concept of balancing personal and professional life. You know, inbuilt in your question is the sort of thinking that personal life is pleasurable, easy, relaxing, and professional life is hard work, taxing. But it's not necessarily always to be like that. I mean, professional life can also be pleasurable, relaxing, and stuff like that. It depends on how you view it.
Right.
So I personally feel this newfangled concept of work-life balance and all is not really, at least not at all relevant for me. And I would tell young people not to take this concept very seriously. It's a dog-eat-dog world in the world of business or entertainment or media or advertising. And it's so difficult to achieve any level of success in these fields. And if you want to achieve something, please keep these fancy concepts of work-life balance and all that, away. Work hard and enjoy your work. And once you enjoy your work, then you don't need the balance.
Fair enough, Sam. I think what I'm going to do is quickly cancel everybody's leave. just joking. So if I was to ask you now, this was an article we came across and there were lessons cited over here. So if you were to just pick three key reasons for your success over the years, if you would just talk about that, that would be great.
Three key reasons for my success.
There is the, Matab, if you could show the next slide.
Yeah. So I think the first reason I would attribute to my success at Madison, I don't know if I mentioned this earlier, is I believe I was successful in advertising and at Madison because fortunately, I'm not a very egoistic or a status conscious person. When I was in Cadbury, I was used to giving orders and dealing with ad agencies. But when I joined an ad agency, I had to take orders. So this important mental switch I was able to do in my mind because the job demanded it.
Right.
So I think the important thing is that if you decide to accept a job or take on a job, then you need to do everything that the job demands. Otherwise, you shouldn't do the job or shouldn't take the job. It's no point trying to take the job and then, bringing your ego into play that, no, I'm the chairman of the company and therefore, I won't do this. I'll let my subordinate do it or all kinds of things like that. I think, therefore, it's best if the ego is left wherever, my second thing is, I would say focus, which we briefly spoke about.
Right.
And I would tell young people that, please focus. Focus on the job at hand. There'll be enough time to party. There'll be enough time to think about everything else. You don't have some God-given talent. I think most of the people are ordinary people with average talent. And yet, those ordinary people with, extraordinary commitment to the job actually achieve extraordinary things. Because extraordinary people are, maybe 0.1%. And those 0.1% achieve extraordinary things. That's no big deal. The important thing is how an ordinary person with ordinary talent can achieve extraordinary things. And I think young people should focus on that. And I'm reminded of a book written by my friend Mauli, unfortunately, who's no more.
Right.
He recently succumbed to cancer. And he gives some very good advice to young people that, your entire working life, you should split into two. The first half or the first 20 years, you should focus on the job and your career and building your expertise and experience and contributing to your company. If you do that very well, then automatically you will begin to earn handsome rewards in the second half. But if you begin to start thinking of your own rewards in the first half of your career, then actually you're doing yourself a disservice because the second half is not going to be then significant. Because the real good payoffs and high payoffs are going to come in the second half of your career. But for that, you have to lay a good foundation in the first half of your career, where you should build your expertise and experience and develop your reputation and all of that. And you have to do that with single-minded focus.
Amazing.
You know, my third thing, that clip that you put up actually reminds me of what I used to say, tell agency bosses that, you know, be physically present. I had read somewhere, a story about the Battle of Waterloo, where it was said that Napoleon's presence alone on the field, on the war field, battlefield, was worth 40,000 soldiers.
Yeah, this one.
So I think, you know, it's very important for leaders to be present at the scene of action. I think they have to lead from the front. I think they can't hide behind their ivory towers or their carpeted cabins. They have to come out there and rub shoulders with the people. And that is how you develop a relationship with people. That is when they have a certain sense of commitment to the agency, to the leader. And clients are quick to recognize those who mean serious business, those who are objective, and they can make out those who are paying only lip service and have got their own self-interest in mind, and those who are genuinely interested in, you know, furthering your business.
Right.
So I would say these are some of the things that young people should look at. One of the things I remember when I think I was passing out my PUC and joining commerce, and I remember meeting the managing director of, I think it was Tata Textiles in Bombay House. And one of the things he told me, stayed with me, is he said, remember, when you're young, don't focus on your salary, and whatever salary you get, please make sure that you contribute to the company at least 10 times the value of your salary, because you should somehow strive to make yourself useful and contribute positively to your company's bottom line. Then you will be readily appreciated, and then nobody can take away the rewards for you. But if from the beginning you're going to focus on rewards, then those rewards are not going to come.
To those who persevere, basically, Sam, right?
Correct. Persevere, and persevere selflessly.
100%. So you're easily the most famous man we know in Indian advertising.
Come on, Raj.
No, seriously. But the thing is, you're Sam to everybody. Why is that?
I don't know what can I say. I guess it comes a little bit from the fact I told you that I don't really have an ego. I think it's good not to take these labels very seriously, because, you know, the press who gives you these labels, I'm keenly aware, can tear you down within minutes or days. But I think the fact is that my personality is such that I like meeting people. I like meeting young people. I want to be friends with them. I want to understand their thinking. And therefore, I like them to call me Sam, because I'm nobody's boss. I'm working along with everybody else to make my clients' brand successful. And I genuinely believe this. It's not a lip service that I'm paying to. And I'm quite happy working on a campaign. I'm quite happy creating a media plan. I'm quite happy taking a brief from a client. And, along with the junior most person in the agency, all these things actually give me a high. They don't bother me at all.
I couldn't agree with you more, Sam. I mean, it's absolutely 100% It's your approachability that makes you who you are, genuinely, that I feel. A very different subject, moving from you to one of the brands that you've closely been sort of involved with. Protecting ideas in advertising has always I felt been a challenge. And back in like the second year of Madison, you went through a sort of situation where the idea that you and Madison created for Synthol Lime pretty much ended up getting stolen by another agency, which is Lintas, for brand Lyril. How did you deal with that? What did you learn from that? And it was all covered in the press and so on and so forth. This is going back again in
time. One of the things I decided is that, look, Lintas may be 100 years old and I may be 1 year old and Lever may be 25 times the size of Godrej, but I'm going to not let that come in the way of standing for what is right. And if they have done something wrong, I want the whole world to know that they've done this wrong thing. So, you know, in those days, if you remember, there was not so much press on advertising or campaigns or all that. Yet, I personally rang up so many journalists and spoke to them and made a big noise about it. In fact, I gave, those days there were no television interviews, but I remember there used to be one India Today's news track. So they featured me and, you know, I think my genuine anger and frustration actually came out in those interviews. And I remember someone saying, look, I don't know the facts of the case, but the way Sam is howling away, I can tell you he means business. And surely he couldn't be putting on an act. So I think it taught me that I think if you are right, irrespective of your size, you know, you should not get bullied or you should not get scared that you're taking on somebody who's, you know, 100 times your size, because you must, you owe it to yourself to let truth come out. And ultimately, I do believe that truth will prevail.
Absolutely. It's a classic David versus Goliath story.
Correct.
In my opinion. So moving from Synthol to election-based advertising, which again, Madison and you have been very much at the center of. So in the early 90s, you worked closely with Murali Deora for the Congress, with the BJP for the last two terms, managing the election advertising and so on. So can you just briefly tell us about the role of advertising and media in both cases?
So thanks to the Ambanis, I was in touch with Murali Bhai, and I think he was, standing as a parliamentarian from South Bombay. And I think our contribution was that we made an issue about the dilapidated buildings, old buildings in South Bombay, and took up the cause of tenants. I think this really rung a bell with the large electorate of South Bombay, especially the lower middle class and the middle classes, all of whom were staying in old buildings as tenants. I think that one idea actually worked brilliantly. And of course, we kind of massaged that idea in an advertising way with rather powerful advertising. So that worked wonderfully well for him. He was, of course, also a very good product because, you know, he was a MP par excellent. He had a lot of accomplishments to his credit. So it was relatively easy to just mirror his achievements in advertising. I think for the BJP, I would say when they came to us, actually, they were not slated to come to power, was the popular impression even they had. So I think we did some strategic work. We put all the states into three different buckets and put intense media pressure only in one bucket, and which made them win handsomely in those states where we did give intense media pressure, which actually led me to comment that, you know, in fact, media can move mountains. And I dare say that most marketing people, I think, or most brands are not as successful as they ought to be, or many fail because their promoters don't give their brands adequate advertising pressure. You know, in advertising, we have an important concept of threshold advertising. So I often say that, you know, if you spend 99 rupees in advertising instead of 100, you stand the risk of losing the entire 99 rupees. But if you spend 101 rupees instead of 100, you stand the risk of losing only 1 rupee. So it's better to waste that 1 rupee than take the risk of losing 99 rupees to save 1 rupee.
Sir, adequate compensation in that sense, correct. So moving from the political parties to some of the most amazing sort of celebrities that you worked with, it's like literally a long queue of who's who, right? Who's the most interesting celebrity that you've worked with in all your years?
Well, I think all celebrities are interesting. I think that's why they get the tag of celebrity. They all have huge achievements behind them, and they have some eccentricity or something interesting always to say. But now that you ask me, actually, I recall one failure that I had in handling one celebrity. That was Richard Gere. You know, I was arranging a press conference for him and Mrs. Parmeshwar Godrej. And, you know, I underestimated, so to speak, the power and influence and attraction of Richard Gere. And whilst I had made all the arrangements of where the press would stand, one of the things I did not provide for was adequate security for Richard Gere and, you know, proper barricades which the press could not cross over. So whilst the press was patiently waiting for him to come, when he actually did arrive with Mrs. Godrej, you know, they got so excited that they just crossed over the barricade and really, you know, went after him and harassed him, and he was a little upset that, you know, there wasn't proper security arrangement for him to be protected. Fortunately, no ugly incident happened, but I somehow do recollect that incident this evening.
Celebrities like Barack Obama and Bill Clinton, I'm sure you've not used them in any advertising.
No. This was just one of those photographs at one of the media functions that was taken, and they were kind enough to send it to me.
Oh, sweet. So you've also worked with virtually all the captains of Indian industry, the most senior MDs, the most senior chairmen, all of them, and helped their brands grow, helped countless brands grow. But in a nutshell, if I was to ask you, why do they all listen to you?
Oh, how do you know they listen to me?
I think it's fair to say that simply because of the number of brands you work with.
I think, Raj, one of the things I'd like to believe is that, you know, I genuinely believe in what I'm doing. I'm not doing anything for money or for my personal prestige or for my personal glory. When I get a job, I devote myself 100% to how to build the client's brand and do everything that is necessary and possible to make the client's brand a success. And I guess somewhere, especially now, given my vast experience over dealing with so many things over so many years, this kind of expertise and experience and honesty of approach comes across. And I think clients are also very sharp people, and they are clients and they are successful because they can assess people very easily. So I guess it comes across. What can I say?
Right. No, absolutely. And I think it's the very fact that the who's who of Indian industry and the leaders of various manufacturers and leaders of various brands have all entrusted their brands to you in some way or the other over the years is testimony to that, quite honestly. Which brings me to Sir Martin Sorrell and his attempts to, from the WPP days, to buy a stake in Madison and so on and so forth. But you turned the tables on him and bought a stake in his company. Why did you do that? What did you feel was the necessity to do that? Because that was nobody, I think, was prepared for that.
Well, I think I can't take the entire credit, whilst I do think that I took the world by storm by doing whatever I did. I would say I got lucky. I had support from Procter & Gamble. And I think my Parsi genes of being eccentric and stubborn helped a bit, because I did not want to, you know, stupidly or cleverly, whichever way you look at it, did not want to part with any equity in Madison. And, you know, that led him to say, okay, fine, you know, if you don't give us equity, we'll give you equity. And that is how the deal came about. And that is how I ended up getting 51% of Mediacom. Now, of course, by prior arrangement, after 7.5 years, I was supposed to give them majority. So I've done that by selling them back 25% equity in Mediacom. So today we have 26% in Mediacom.
Yeah, but undoubtedly it's something that took everybody.
Yes, I think it took everybody. That is why you will see, I see that you are flashing some pictures from the press. The press was all gaga about it.
I must say it
gave me and Madison a leg up, because, you know, everybody was expecting that I would give WPP a majority in Madison, and therefore it shocked them that actually I ended up taking up majority in Mediacom.
Correct. Classic turning of the tables. But such a long and illustrious career, I was also thinking, there would have been some low point, impossible for it to be entirely...
Well, I think the low point clearly in my professional career is the photograph that you have put up, you know, sometime in 95, thanks to, again, to Procter & Gamble and Godrej coming together, we got introduced to this global agency called DMB&B, and we sort of tied up with them. But then soon I got the feeling that, you know, they were flexing their muscles and they were becoming unreasonable. So I had the guts to actually not submit to their pressures. And then the deal came unstuck. And because of this, actually, I lost within 1 year 70% of Madison Billings. So 70%. That was clearly the rudest shock of my life. That clearly was something that I had not anticipated. I had anticipated some loss, but not loss to this extent. And I remember in those days when I was a little feeling down, not out, reading hearing on CNBC, which was a new channel then, a Southeast Asian gentleman say that real success can come only after real failure. And I took that to heart. And I must say, I kept my chin up and we fought and worked hard and we gained back a lot of business. And today, of course, we are much larger than what we were.
Amazing. So after losing 70%, to build it all back is back
many times over.
Right. While on the one hand, we've just discussed a big low, obviously, again, such a long career studded with amazing highs as well. So many accolades. I mean, right at the beginning of the session, I just reeled off a long list and I went through not even half of what you've achieved. But if I was to ask you, which is the one accolade or award that you have received that is the most precious to you, which one would that be?
So Raj, first let me tell you that when you finish 48 years of working life, it is but natural that you collect some accolades. So I don't think just collecting these accolades, whilst of course they're good and I value them and I appreciate them, I think you must see them in perspective that I've been around for so long and consistently doing the same things that, I have to win some. But anyway, I guess the winning the 3 years of my lifetime achievement award so early in my life, I think I won it almost 10 years ago.
12.
I remember 12 years ago, I remember my acceptance speech, I said that, look, just winning this award does not mean that I'm going to retire. And here I am 12 years later, still actively involved in the business.
In fact, that's them standing ovation. Matab, if you could show the previous slide. Yeah, that's the entire the advertising industry giving you a standing ovation.
Correct. That's good.
Yeah. So if I was to ask you, your career has been as glittering as and continues to be. So what's your message to young advertising and media professionals today?
Well, I thought we spoke about it. You asked me about advice for young people, and I said one is your ego at home,
right,
when you come to work. Second one is focus, and focus on the job at hand. Don't worry about your own remuneration and your position and your designation. Immerse yourself with the job at hand and do an outstanding job of that, and spend the first half of your career actually developing your own personal expertise, developing your profile, developing your experience. And if you do all of this well and admirably, then you will get very high rewards in the second half. But if you focus on getting rewards in the first half, this is not my original thinking. This is actually the thinking of my friend Wauli, who puts it so eloquently in his book.
Understood. No, but yeah, can't deny that. Can't completely agree with that. So we've been talking about your career for a bit and how started it has been with success. But all of this cannot have possibly happened without Humay helping you focus on all your entrepreneurial dreams. But if there was, again, one most crucial way that she has helped you, what would that be?
I think the most crucial way that she has helped was, she let me be. She did not impose on my time. She did not make things difficult by saying, oh, we have to go for this and go for that. There have been occasions when, you know, I remember I had to disappoint her and a couple friend of ours from Bangalore. We were to go from Bombay to Goa and they were flying in from Bangalore. And I had a Nelco shoot that got that had to get cancelled because the model had to be changed at the last minute. So I had to cancel that holiday. And there have, of course, been innumerable occasions when we've had to cancel personal dinners and not appear at dinner parties and all that because, you know, I'm still at home, although she's ready and all set to go. So I think she took all this in a stride and that was very nice. I mean, I know a lot of women who would make their husband's lives miserable. But I think she braced it quite well, and I think in that way supported me silently by helping in whatever small way she could.
Amazing. You're blessed with the amazing Tanya and Lara. If I was to ask you, how does Tanya inspire you? What would you say?
I think my Tanya inspires me the most. And I kind of very often think, when I brood over some of my problems or challenges at work, I just have to look at her and see her lively, bubbly self and think that, look, what am I brooding about? Yes, she does not have sight and yet she is so cheerful and bubbly and happy with life. So in that way, she is a real big inspiration to me.
Inspiration to all of us, Sam, in that sense. I mean, this is the video we have of Tanya.
Oh, good. Wonderful. What does she say?
Hi. So I'm here to talk to you about my amazing relationship that I share with my dad. So I am extremely grateful, first of all, to my dad because it's because of him that I have reached where I have. I have a very friendly and like a childlike relationship with him. I do, of course, tend to bully him, but at the same time, I respect his wishes and I do tend to listen to him more than I listen to my mom. I cannot afford to have my dad get angry at me. I don't like it when he's upset with me. Very special memories with him when we were small. Many a times he used to take me and my sister to SL World and other amusement parks. I particularly remember in Las Vegas to the best roller coaster in the world, the thing called Stratosphere. He had taken me there. I enjoyed it so much. It was surely the best roller coaster ride I've ever had. Lots of special memories with my dad and my little nephew and niece, Kyra and Carl, who we are the most attached to. Ethics at the Tanya Computer Center, we believe in honesty. I like to, I believe that honesty is the most important ethic. And I think my students and my friends around me know that they can trust me. In fact, one of my friends recently paid me a very big compliment. He doesn't know me so well, but he said that I am very trustworthy and I was very happy to hear that, because I think trust is easily the most important thing that can be lost and the easiest to lose. I mean, the most difficult to win and the easiest to lose. So I think being trustworthy is the most important. I thoroughly enjoy imparting computer training to my students. And we believe that all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. So that is it about me and my relationship with my dad.
Thank you, Tanya. So Raj, how are we doing on time? I think it's really getting late. Should we not be now bringing this to a close?
Don't worry, Sam. If you've got the time, we've got the time. It's fascinating. But you didn't tell the favorite story of mine, which I wanted you to share, but we'll keep that for the last.
Okay.
Yeah, Chana. We have Lara's bit. So, Sam, I'll move more quickly as well myself. So, what does it feel like to have Lara, your daughter, as the executive director at Madison? How is your working with her? How does she inspire you?
Oh, for me, it's wonderful. I don't know how it is for her. I hope it is wonderful too. But I think as a father, it's lovely for me to have her around, because, you know, I know she wants exactly the same thing that I want. Of course, I think she provides also, as somebody else had said, the perfect yang to my yin. So whilst I get all worked up and hassled over every petty little problem, she's the cool, calm and collected one who sort of, after a discussion with her, I feel reassured that it's not so bad as I'm making it out to be. She has also, I must confess, stopped me from taking some rash decisions, because when I tend to, because of my baggage of experience and emotional attachment to some pet ideas, she has taken more a cool, calm, distant and maturely thought look and prevented us from getting into some new projects which would have been disastrous for Madison to undertake.
Amazing. So, I mean, I can attest to Lara being a sort of fountain of calm in that sense for her, for sure, because one interacts with her so much. Please play the video. Yeah.
So my dad, of course, has been a big influence in my life. Growing up, of course, we didn't see as much of him. But what I very clearly remember is every time he was around, which used to be on Sundays, it used to be an absolute holiday, and he used to do everything possible to have a lot of fun with us. Like, I remember every Sundays he used to take us to the beach. Of course, now it's amazing that I have the opportunity to work with him. He's been a big part of my ethics when it comes to work, and just working with him at Madison is absolutely wonderful. I've obviously learned a lot from him. Now I think it's just amazing to see him play and interact with my children.
Which brings me to your what's your favorite activity with them, Sam, with Carl and Kyra?
Oh, we are playing all the time, doctor, mama, baby, and what not.
thanks to the lockdown,
I think the most powerful thing I can say on the GeoParsi platform is for all daughters and sons to have babies quickly, if not for their own sake, for their grandfather and grandmother's sake, because there's no greater pleasure for a grandfather and grandmother than to play with the grandchildren, and the amount of joy that they can give, you know, equals to nothing else in this world.
How absolutely true, Sam. Since you've we were going to, I was going to ask you about the fact that you're such a leading light of the Parsi community. But what do you think is your role in the community? If I was to ask you that, how do you feel committed to the community, and what do you feel is your role?
As I get a little older, I think I kind of feel more strongly about certain pressure points in the community, and there are a lot of them, you know, besides the fact of our dwindling population. There are some things that are going wrong in our Bombay Parsi Panchayat, which is actually, in a way, the nerve center of the Parsi community around the world. Lots of things going wrong there. Lots of things going wrong with, I think, ambition of Parsi families. I don't see enough fire in young Parsi boys. I think the girls are doing fine. So it's a matter of big concern to me. I think even our WZCC entrepreneurship scheme that we have, wherein we give loans of 25 lakhs to interest-free, we find we have more money than actually takers. So that's quite depressing. So I would like to help in some way get the spark back on entrepreneurship. The way our forefathers were known for entrepreneurship, when they had very little going for them, they actually left the comfort of their homes and traveled within India and very often outside India to Hong Kong and China and distant places and did trade with them. And that is real entrepreneurship. Today's young people seem to be taking it easy. They have a house, they have a comfortable house, they anyway get a comfortable breakfast, lunch, dinner. So they want to take the easy way out, as saying, where is the need to strive? I'm comfortable, my parents are happy. And I think parents also don't sort of push our children enough to achieve something bigger and more important in life. So I think that's a slightly negative role that Parsi parents play, especially in a boy's upbringing, is my observation. I hope I'm not being too harsh, but I wish, you know, our young community would be bigger achievers than they actually are.
Wow. Okay. There were a couple of questions in this space that I wanted to ask you, but you've actually touched upon most of the things that I wanted to ask you. But if I was to ask you, among young Parsis, is there anybody you either admire or dislike, and why?
I think there is nobody who I dislike. I think by nature, I like everyone.
Okay.
I think my nature is not to, dislike anyone. I would say amongst young people, I think amongst Parsis, I think one of the persons that stands out for me is Jimmy Mistry, who I know reasonably well. And I recently had occasion to visit his Khandala property.
Right.
He's built an amazing thing of, Della Estates, Della Adventure Park, Della Hotel. It's wonderful. And I think it makes you feel good that a young Parsi has achieved so much. And I wish more people would take inspiration for him and we need at least 100 Jimmy mysteries, you know, in order to build back our reputation of entrepreneurship and enthusiasm.
I mean, that's straight up, that's your message to the younger parties for sure.
Absolutely.
Yeah, I mean, so, but you touched upon Geoparsi when you were speaking about your grandchildren, you touched upon Geoparsi. So why, while Sharnaz spoke about how she met you and me right at the outset, but why did you feel it, you know, necessary to partner Parzor in this initiative? And what is your view of the initiative, if you could sort of just touch upon that?
So, you know, I don't know if you remember, but when Shena spoke to us first, it was right. about actually popularizing the IVF treatment and get more takers for it. And I felt, Raj, that, you know, number one, besides my overall thinking that I should do a little bit more for the community, I thought it was a wonderful opportunity for us as Madison and for me personally to contribute my personal expertise and skills to this, you know, burning a community problem. You know, right. Otherwise on a day-to-day basis, we are involved in commercial activity of selling soap and shampoo and, you know, hotel rooms and whatnot. But it's not often that you get an opportunity to get to do something for a whole community. And, you know, we began to conceptualize this in a much broader framework. So we as you know, we kind of enlarged the objective from just merely promoting IVF treatments to actually, you know, marrying Parsis, marrying early, having at least two children and stuff like that. So that, and I think clearly, you know, one of my pet beliefs, as you know, is that if it's safe, it's risky. So
right.
I knew that we didn't have too much advertising money to go behind the campaign. The campaign should work on its own without any media, advertising media support. And therefore, the campaign had to be mildly provocative. It had to be viable, and that is exactly what the campaign achieved. I think also, in my view, a good outstanding campaign always has some detractors, and I think the Geoparsi campaign also, true to that, had, but I would say not more than a dozen detractors, and you know, actually, the detractors unknowingly also did a good job for Geoparsi because of the detractors, I think the campaign became more viable and more famous, and more people got to know about it because, you know, the papers carried the contrary view too.
Absolutely. In fact, this particular creative that Amul ran, if I, just speaking from my personal experience, while having been part of many, many campaigns over the years and so on and so forth, it is the first time that, in my experience at least, that Amul had done a hoarding celebrating another advertising campaign. Right.
Correct. Yeah. Right.
It's very rare that they always pick up topical issues, but here was an advertising campaign that ended up becoming the most topical issue of that time. So which was something that I also hold very sort of closely to my heart. So you've of course gone on yourself. You've gone on record saying that the Geoparsi campaign is one of the closest to your heart. Over the nearly 5-decade-long career that you've had. But what more, if I was to ask you, would you want the campaign, any new campaign to try and do, if you could talk about that?
Well, I think Shehnaz has conceptualized this very well. And I think if you see our 3 or 4 different phases, I think they've all been conceptualized very very beautifully to give it a holistic kind of approach. So we are not just telling people to have babies, we are giving them support in terms of help and people who can look after the babies. We are giving them financial help to look after older parents. So it's a tremendous effort. I think we just have to pursue it. Also, the fact that Shehnaz recently announced that we have crossed the 300 babies mark is indeed wonderful news. And I think we have to just keep at it. Right. We have to not lose focus and not get distracted. And we have to just keep at it. And I'm sure sooner than later, more people will say that thanks to the GeoParsi campaign, we have at least postponed the decimation of the Parsi community by at least several decades.
Fantastic. So I was going to ask you if there's something every family, every Parsi family specifically, should practice to preserve Parsi tradition and heritage. But would I be right in saying that maybe actually espousing the principles that the GeoParsi campaigns have tried to sort of give to people is at least one thing that they need to do to...
Of course. I mean, I think the first thing that a Parsi family needs to do is beyond doubt, impress on the children that they should marry a Parsi. I think... I think it makes good sense all round. Not just, I'm saying this not just from a community perspective, but from their own perspective, of familiarity, of equal social status, similarity of habits, similarity of upbringing. All these play a very important role in companionship and living life, living for decades and decades together. So I think Parsis should impress upon their children from the beginning about the need to marry a Parsi. And I think everybody should follow Lara's example of how she, after marriage, had two babies in quick succession. And I think that is also the GeoParsi message which Lara took to heart. And I think, I hope others follow this message.
Fantastic, absolutely. To sort of wind this up, I have one last question for you. Where do you see Madison 10 years from now?
So it's very simple. I see Madison stronger, I see Madison bigger, I see Madison brighter, I see Madison more digitally focused, I see Madison more automated, I see Madison using artificial intelligence, I see Madison completely up to speed with all the new gizmos that are going to come in the next 10 years. As you know, in our media business, we have put up the photograph of Vikram Sakuja. Vikram is now our partner in Madison Media. He has operated on a global stage. He was the CEO of a global company called Maxis. And he recently came back, not recently, 5 years ago, he came back from New York. So we are constantly sort of embellishing, refurbishing, augmenting Madison capability to make sure that we have what it takes.
Fantastic. Shehnaz, there's a small sort of footnote I have for the session, which is personally my experience of working with Sam since the last 9 years. It's a very short thing. So the very fact that I've had the privilege of working closely with Sam for the nearly 9 years now, I've been absolutely sort of inspired by his unflinching honesty, the clarity that he brings to leadership, all his will and determination, the absolute lack of hesitation if he has to beat up somebody, verbally, fortunately, and not physically. But all the success that is the focus on success being at the center of what he does, and the absolutely unassuming humility which crowns all of that, right? And this has been my unique privilege on a day-to-day basis that I have personally felt working closely with Sam. What he packs into one day, most I would say would struggle to pack into seven, because just to give you a sense, he'll visit two cities, he'll attend an industry forum, he'll solve client issues, he'll lead a new business pitch, speak to publications, resolve ASCII issues, and wash it all down with a media party in the evening. And he's been doing this for nearly 5 decades. So Sam, I just want to say to you, absolutely, from the bottom of my heart, more power to you.
Thank you, Raj, for your kind words. You're generous with your words.
No, I think I would also like to add to that. I know Sam doesn't want this to be spoken about, but with Jio Parsi, by the way, we crossed 310 babies yesterday, Sam.
Oh, wonderful.
So that is really good news, because it was 120 to 200 babies over the last 20 years. So I think by crossing 310, it's great news. Thank you, Sam. And I have to say that your personal help to people, whenever I have reached out to you for the really difficult cases we have, your personal help has gone so far, has actually brought children into people's lives. And I'm going to end with a question, with a request to Lara. Lara had her first, we met Lara before she was married. Lara had her first baby with the first campaign, her second baby between the second and third campaign. Now we're going in for our next campaign, according to Raj. So now, Lara, we want a third baby, please. Then you will be a really, Lara, the inspirational force behind Jio Parsi, along with Sam and Raj. Thank you so much, Sam. It's been a wonderful, wonderful evening. And people are commenting and saying thank you. And we all appreciate your taking so much time out for us, sharing so much. And the book has to be done. You have told us so many stories. Now, after this, I'm not going to keep you any longer. But there's a very interesting story which is going into your book, if not on the tape today. God bless you, Sam. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Raj.
Thank you, audience. You've been wonderful. And God bless you all. Thank you, Matab, for all your work and all your help. And for organizing everything so beautifully. Thank you very much. Good night. God bless you.
Good night. Bye, Shanaz.
Bye. God bless. Thank you.
Bye.